So we'll do this now. This is now part two. So we welcome our viewers, our listeners, well, our viewers to part two. Okay. Go ahead, Jay.
Hi. Yes. Well, it was in the middle of COVID. And I think, you know, because of lockdowns, I was feeling very constrained. I think we all did. And so, you know, I felt that there was always a lot more that I could learn and explore. And I felt that, you know, the skills that I had couldn't properly let me do the kinds of projects I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Or, yeah. And so it made sense to me to look for something multidisciplinary that would take me around the world, encounter all sorts of different ideas. Mm-hmm. And I guess I ended up with a program that was just as scattered as my interests were. Which is what drew me to it.
Yeah. Maybe just, you know, just one important thing that I always try to ask people is, what nurtured this kind of... I mean, I knew you were into the arts because as I shared with people at the start, no, when I would visit your home, I think I had breakfast a couple of times, and it was really music. No, I knew you were very into music at the time. But what nurtured your interest, and what nurtured your, and what gave you the opportunities to explore and discover your passion? I think it's very important for young people to hear, and also for parents to hear. No, for parents to hear.
Yeah. Of course. I was always interested in drawing. And okay, this is where it gets really interesting. And I think a lot of parents might cringe at this, but I think what got me into 3D modeling and animation and 3D design, which ultimately landed me here in London, I feel like I wouldn't have gotten to where I am without this.
Okay.
Without this skill set that I have now. This skill set came from my interest in video games.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to love
now we're getting into an interesting field. I think that a lot of parents need to hear. Okay.
And yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I think a lot of interests that kids have can be extremely productive in unique ways. I was interested in this game called Team Fortress, and it's a first person shooting game. So you go around making people explode. But you have to customize how your character looks. And I was always interested in designing new hats, new equipment for the characters. And so I taught myself how to do that by sitting at my desk and listening to YouTube videos for hours.
Okay.
And this was in high school. So while my friends and I were playing these video games, when they would stop playing, I would go on YouTube and learn how to 3D model. And so my interest in you know, video games eventually turned into an interest in 3D design, which ended in turned into an interest in animation. And so one thing led to another, and I ended up here. And I think that's something my parents have always let me explore.
Yeah.
They weren't necessarily.
But also maybe if I could add, but you were also a good student in the traditional. So I guess you had the license to explore, no? You did well in school, no? The traditional courses were okay. So anyway, I just want to add that. You know, so
my grades paid for my gaming time.
Yeah.
No, I was.
Well, you know, as I always say, Jay, do the things you need to do so that you can do the things you would love to do.
Yeah.
Just fulfill the requirements first, then explore. And then your parents really are very supportive, no?
Extremely.
I think they never force you to, you need to go into medicine. Your grandfather is one of these pillars of biochemistry. So yeah, really a supportive environment is very important. But at the same time, I like what you said, no? My grades paid for my gaming time, no? Because part of it is the balance, no? And I think that you will not get to where you are now without that balance. And I think part of balance is discipline. Mm. And then the discipline that will allow you to pursue your passion, no? I think that's very important. Clearly that worked very well for you, no? So anyway, back to getting into London. And let me ask this question, because I'll give a background to this question, Jay, no, so that you could perhaps share more your own feelings about it. No? As I mentioned earlier, our work now with Eski. You remember Eski, no? Eski, the dad of Basti. So anyway, our work, Eski and I work together in Magna Anima Teachers College. And we are doing this out-of-school youth program. As I said, we wanted to create a program that will be very, very, a lot of innovation. And we want to introduce STEAM into it, no? And one of our partners is MIT, okay? In fact, we visited MIT because MIT's program is that they want to, they feel that we can scale up this program using technology, no? Online learning, online modules, no? And clearly you've had that experience because the last year and a half of your college was basically online, no? I'm sure you started off exploring and getting into this program because that was partly the height of the pandemic, although it was tapering off by the time you went to your college in London, no? And I'd like to ask you to share that experience because I think the future is there. It's a good mix of going online, meeting people. You know, you still need to do face-to-face encounters and all that. How has that been experience? How has that experience been for you? No? That mix of online and then coming face-to-face, collaborating. So, and maybe I want to add one more thing. No? I also met with the Employers Confederation of the Philippines, and its head shared the experience of his, I think his driver, no? His driver took an online course and eventually became skilled in IT, no? And now his job is receiving contracts from companies in the US, no? And it's paying him a lot. And one of our programs now for the out of school youth, we're preparing them to get into IT jobs, no? So because I think that's where a lot of the jobs would be, no? And we want to get away, no? In our out of school youth program, we want to get in a way, get out of that tradition of just preparing them to go into the hospitality, the tourism sector, but try to really prepare them for more cutting edge. But in a while, as you said, no, everything started as cutting edge, and then after a few years, they're traditional. No? So, but how has that experience been for you? No? That combination of going online and at the same time experiencing face-to-face encounter with people of the same interest, no?
Yeah, I think I want to nuance this by saying, like, it is kind of a double-edged sword. And now that I am encountering most things in person, I very much prefer interacting with people. But when it comes to gathering knowledge, I think it's hard to deny that, like, a lot of the skill sets that I've personally built have come from online courses, have come from
YouTube, the University YouTube. Of YouTube. Yeah,
exactly. It's so powerful. And that's one of the strengths of it, is that, like, I could be interested in something as specific as character modeling and animation, and not have necessarily the social resources to access that kind of information, but online it's right there. And so I think it's that ability to let people create their own modules and their own ways of learning that online spaces empower. I think my last few years in Ateneo really suffered from, you know, the lack of physical social interaction. I think creating communities for knowledge exchange is something that's essential. And it's a little more difficult to do online, but it's not impossible. I was trying to run an organization in Ateneo for our designers, but because we had a hard time coordinating because it was entirely online, you know, that fell off. But I think they're trying to revive it. Anyway, where am I going with this?
Yeah, the balance between online and you know, actual face-to-face connections, yeah, which I think is very
important.
And I like what you said, though, that online really is where you get the knowledge. No, it's all out there, and even the development of the skills. No, but as you also mentioned, the synthesis of everything that you learn still is best done. No, it's with the community. No, still with the community. No, so because it's interesting, because lately I've been talking to different dioceses. No, and I always talk about the term professionalism. No, I was telling them that my professor back in 1985, 86, the Father Jim Donnellan, he said, the original use of the term, well, one of the early uses of the term professionalism is that you belong to a guild, no? You belong to a guild of designers, a guild of painters, a guild of carvers, and you work with a master, you work with the community, and this community, they become professional carvers, professional painters, because they profess their love for the field, no? And that's why they become professionals, no? So, interesting, because basically I think that's what you're also experiencing, no? And trying to pursue, no? And trying to, I guess, to develop in people of the same passions and interests coming together and creating, no? Creating, no? So,
yes.
Jay, okay, maybe you could give some, well, I don't want to call it advice, no? But you could share some stories that hopefully will serve as guides or inspirations to people like you, no? Young people now, perhaps people in senior high school trying to figure out, okay, what do I want to take? Where do I want to go? And even people in college who thinking of what job to get or what further studies to do. And also for parents, no? How to encourage their children. And of course, special, important for parents, no? Gaming is not all that bad. I think that's very important to share. So maybe you could give us some thoughts on that.
Yeah, okay. I think one of my favorite insights from one of my favorite creative people is from Ez Devlin. I'm paraphrasing here because I can't remember the quote entirely, but in entirety, but this idea that it's okay to try everything. You know what? Forget that it's a quote, you know, let me just like restart. Okay. I think if I had to give any advice, and this has worked for me, and I know this comes from a very privileged standpoint of having access to people and resources, but I think it's something that people can bring about in their own way. It's that if you have interests and don't know which interests to choose, then don't choose. Follow every path as long as you can. Yeah, it's something I remember. I think I heard it from a designer named Ez Devlin, but I also heard it from one of the priests I was close with in high school, Father Xavier Olin. And,
who is the provincial now of the Jesuits?
Wow.
He was appointed the provincial of the Philippine province of the Jesuits.
Yeah. That's incredible.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. I thought that would be good news for you. No? Okay, what did you learn news. From Father Xavier? Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's and it's something that I hear that for some reason along my journey has come up in different spaces in different ways. And it's that if you can't choose between two paths, follow both of them and see where they lead. In my case, I was interested in art and design and technology, and somehow I landed in a space that brought them all together. And so, you know, if you're interested in video games or anything, right, don't sacrifice one for the other if you don't have to. And I think maybe that works for a lot of parents as well. You know, I think this idea of a mold that a child has to be. I speak to a lot of people back home and, you know, like this an idea for what the perfect kid is supposed to be and as an idea of how you're supposed to grow up. But what if there are multiple versions of the ideal self, diba? And what if you try to pursue all of them to the best of your abilities? I feel like you'll get somewhere productive instead of trying to pick a path. At least in my case, that has worked so far.
Yeah, and you know, and I think when young people are much younger, no, you should allow them to pursue all interests.
You know, yes,
it's gonna zero in. Maybe just one point, no, that I'd like to hear from you about. What brought it together? What became the synthesis point, if you wish, no, of your interest? No?
I think one thing that has really enabled it has been finding people with the same interests.
Okay.
Because in my case, you know, I have all of these interests that are quite broad, mm-hmm. but it's so hard to bring them together and produce something from it. And I found that by bringing other people together who share a little bit of those interests, you know, you kind of create a team that's way more capable than you will ever be. And this isn't even in terms of like team building. My partner, she's a writer. She's working on a comic, and I find that my conversations with her are like so creatively stimulating that I never have with anyone else. My best friend, I have like my best friends are all like creators in some way or another.
Yeah,
like
yeah. I, yeah. It's a community. It's a like, guild. It's a guild, no?
Yeah, it's basically a guild. A
guild of professionals who love the field, no?
Yeah. And so I want to say that the people I surround myself with complete all of these interests that I've developed over time and turn them into something productive. So yeah, that has worked for me. But zeroing in. Okay, that's a really interesting question because I would say I'm still in the process of zeroing in. I'm currently working on a bunch of simultaneous projects that are all like wildly different. But so far, so good.
You know, you mentioned you were in Singapore for a while, or you worked with a teacher or someone.
I was in Singapore for a while.
We're in Singapore because, you know, I used to work, I worked for 2 years, no, in the Philippine High School for the Arts in Makiling, no? And there's a group of Singaporeans who were beginning to talk with and supposedly develop a partnership with, but I left, and so that never pushed through. But they came to offer a program that will help the artists create a profession out of their craft, no? Of their art. Mm-hmm. No? So it's really combining, you know, because there's this old idea, no, that artists are always starving artists. No? So that's and they say that a lot of the, for example, the great painters internationally and here in the Philippines, you know, they're very poor when they're painting, but after they die, their works sell for ridiculous amounts, no? So, but clearly, nowadays your field is something that's very it's not just a profession, but in terms of pursuing your passion, but it's also something that let me rephrase my question, no? Because one of my favorite lines about education, maybe we can end with this, and then we can show your video, right? We can show your video.
Of course.
Yeah, you own the intellectual property rights are yours, right? So we can air it. Anyway, maybe we'll end with this, your thoughts on this. Father Hans Kung, I always quote him when I talk about education, and I feel this is what education should do. He said, for a person to live a full human life, he said, you have to give him three things, him or her three things. One is, yes, he needs something to live on, basic, but he needs something to live for, interest, purpose. But the third, I think, is the most important. And I think this is what synthesizes all our interests. You need to give him something to die for, something that he's ready to commit to as a life work, as a life career, as a project. So can you comment on that, maybe in your own journey?
Absolutely. In my case, I think it's always felt intuitive to me that I needed to create beautiful things in the world. And not just for any practical reason, or I think there's something wonderful about that. Okay, hold on. Let me. I'm just gonna take a second to process this because I think that's a wonderful quote.
Don't worry about pausing. We can edit it now. So
of course. Thank you for the edits.
Okay.
I hope I don't need too
take
many.
Your time. Take your time. Take your time, and we'll just pick up from the moment you begin. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I'll take a minute. Live on, live for, and die for. I think a lot of people intuitively know what they want to live for. Maybe when they were kids, they had some idea. But that gets eclipsed with the need to live on something, right? And that's understandable. You know, we live in this capitalist world. It's a society that has been constructed around us. So, you know, we operate within it. And so we have to consider what to live on. But I think in my case, and I'm really lucky, I've found a way to sustain that which I live for, which is the production of unique experiences and beautiful things, which I've been very fortunate to do. I think one of the great struggles is to somehow find that balance between the thing you live on, you live for, and you die for. Yeah, and especially when you're young, I think it's really easy to think that the most important thing is to sustain yourself. And it definitely is. But for creatives like myself, I think it's definitely possible, especially now, right, to take the skill set that you have and find a way to make it something sustainable.
Yeah,
I mean, that's still something I'm looking into myself. Yeah. But I think there are so many avenues for creative support And I think it bleeds into something I've been saying this whole conversation, which is that for me, I've always tried to break out of whatever alley I was in and branch into other things. You know, if I was interested in technology and art, I try something with both. Mm-hmm. And I think it's that sort of divergent thinking that would allow people to turn the things they live for into hopefully things they can live on as well.
Yeah, yeah.
But honestly, I think for my generation, that is something we are all working out together.
Yeah.
And it is an important balance. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. You know, and I think our education system and our families, you know, should also begin to reflect on this. You know, how do you help people like you, young people, just starting out in their careers, in their professions? You know, how do you help them create that balance? You know? As you said, it's very mm-hmm. easy to let one part eclipse the other, no? So
yeah,
I think as Father Hans Kung put it, no, all three must be there, no? All three must be there, no? And it's almost like you build each stage, no, one on top of the of each other, but at a certain point when you have it all together, it becomes a dynamic whole, no? It doesn't become anymore 1, 2, 3, no, but it becomes a whole system, a whole ecosystem, if you wish, of how to live your life, no? So, wow. So thank you very much, JJ. And, you know, I look forward to working with you. I look forward to collaborating with you in creating a program. Because, you know, Jay, there are 20 million Filipinos who never completed basic education. And our goal with Caritas Philippines, so Alay Kapwa Community School, is just to reach, or if we reach even just a small percentage of that group, then hopefully create a program that can be scaled up even by different people, then that would be great. And as we said earlier in the first episode, I think we mentioned that the future of jobs, and we're talking about jobs here, something to live on, is really along the lines of STEAM. And I guess Ars Electronica, I think they've seen the future very well. And I think that's your type of field. It's marrying STEM, science, technology, etc., but the arts always will be there, no? So again, Jay, we'll show your video, no? We'll show your videos after this, but thank you very much, and I look forward to having coffee with you when you come home, no? And really sort of just explore ways to bring your experience, your journey, and allow more young people to take similar journey that you took, no? Any parting shot, Jay?
Let your kids play video games.
Excellent, excellent end to this conversation. So, and JJ, thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing you back here. And maybe we can plan something, even just create a workshop or something. So, again, thank you very
of
much.
This so much. Yeah.
And we'll let people watch your video. And what will we show first? The one you created in Austria and then the one that won the prize. Okay.
That makes sense.
Okay, thank you, Jay. Thank you very much. And so thank you, Ma'am Kapamilya, and enjoy JJ's video.
I can't feed 5,000, but I can feed one. I can't walk in water, but I can walk in the shoes of another. I can't turn water into wine, but I can turn a frown into a smile.
I can't be there for all the people in need, but I can be the answer to someone's prayer by sharing at least 500 pesos every year to Ale Kapwa.
Sharing what I have in my hands is the miracle that needs to be seen today. This is what I can share. This is my Ale Kapwa. Ale Kapwa, a flagship program of Caritas Philippines by the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines.